for prime gear.
We used to cut school to go home and do music, you know, and then we just started making stuff up. And then one day I had a friend of mine named Slick Rick, who I was doing a record with, and I came up with an idea called The Show.
The Show.
The Show.
He brought this song, The Show, to me, and it sounded like a bunch of commercials. And he said, what could I do with this song to make it really appealing, you know, to the clubs, to the streets?
It took the best elements of the melodic style of R&B married to some DC go-go with some hip-hop, James Brown, drum sample.
I said to him, what you got to do is keep the beat going.
And from that point, you knew he had the knack to, you know, really help you cultivate your ideas and really get them out there in the way that you wanted them to be out there.
The record became a big hit.
I would call him the hidden genius for the fact that he was not too flashy upon what he can do. He was behind the scenes.
We used to do these little clubs. Actually, one of the clubs was called The Rooftop on 155th Street over there by the Polo Grounds. It was all ghetto, but Teddy Riley was proving his skills even back then.
Teddy's Uncle Willie, co-owner of the Rooftop roller skating rink, built him a recording studio where Teddy spent most of his time producing emerging rappers.
I got with Kumo D.
Go see the doctor.
I did a beat for Heavy D, Mr. Big Stuff.
I make you dance and prance till you huff and puff. There's just no way you can get.
Everybody would just come to get a beat, like it was a candy store.
I'm the overweight prince, dominator MC, heavy D, constant weight gainer.
I was recognized by a great friend of mine, Clive Calder, who signed me to Zomba and told me if I found a group, he would sign me to Jive Records. And I did exactly what he told me to do. And when I found that group, I took it to Jive Records. And you know what that group was? That group was Guy. And they turned us down. I met Aaron in Jersey City. And we were talking. Timmy Gatlin bought him. And we were just playing. I was playing some songs for him. He was playing. Incredible keyboard player. He's playing some chords that I'd never seen before in my life. And then I just started playing them. And because I play by ear, you know, I don't look at no book for chords, but I had seen his chord progressions and just bugged me out. I said, yo, man, we gotta get together. And Timmy said, it can't be a group. I want you to come and produce, you know, me and Aaron. And Aaron said, nah. If he ain't in the group, I ain't no group.
In 1986, Guy, under management of previously estranged mentor Gene Griffin, is signed to Uptown Records by ghetto entrepreneur Andre Harrell.
Uptown was basically Teddy's groove and my ability to talk to executives about what the music represented to us people.
Andre Harrell, who it's really, you know, given us as Guy, Timmy Gatlin, Aaron Hall, and myself, an incredible hope.
A lot of people don't realize this, but I got into the music game by being an intern. My first job was carrying Teddy Riley's keyboard at a WBLS show in New York at the Palladium. If it wasn't for me carrying his keyboard, I don't even know if I'd be here.
Meanwhile, Teddy began to produce songs for other artists, including Al B. Sure.
He had just so many things on his mind and things that he wanted to talk about in his songs. Night and Day, the biggest song for him to really, like, express himself.
Teddy had a lot of input on the song. He was in there telling me to sing, ooh, whoa, all of that. All of that, the ooh, 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 ah.
Ghetto classic.
At At the dawn of the release of the self-titled Guy album, Timmy Gatlin exits to pursue a solo career and is replaced by Aaron's brother, Damian Hall.
The first time I heard Groove Me, I was at a skate, roller skating rink in the Bronx called Skate Key. It was New Year's Eve. Groove Me came on, the dance floor went absolutely bananas.
I wanted to know who did it. That was the first thing. And to know that he was so young, I was incredibly amazed.
The whole church was brought into the thing. You know, you had the big harmonies, the riffs, and the whole, you know, it sounded like you was in church at a hip-hop convention at the same time.
That's right. The party wasn't over. It was just beginning. The album sold over a million copies, and the impact was heard and felt everywhere.
I said, baby, why don't you sing? Mama, I can't sing. I said, baby, don't tell me what you can't do. I'm telling you what you could do.
In the midst of Guy's success, Teddy continued to crank out the hits. Suck. Out the hits.
Suck MCs, I'll make your girl say ow. And she's jocking. Now how you like me now? We prefer to fight you all like a man and beat you down with our hands. The body slam you at the wall, wall, wall.
We got into an argument over my prerogative because he didn't want to sing that way. He walked out of the studio on me, but he knows I want it this way in the studio. And I got to have it this way. You got to trust me. And it took us about 2 hours to get him back in the studio to sing my prerogative.
Describing Teddy's new sound, journalist Barry Michael Cooper of The Village Voice coined the phrase New Jack Swing, a musical hybrid that combined hip-hop beats with R&B, inspired by the urban youth experience.
With hip-hop and R&B together, how I did it, I don't know how, but I just did it. I didn't call it New Jack Swing. At first I called it sophisticated bubblegum music because it was young.
That record honestly took us 15 minutes to do.
It's hard to describe. He gave you, you know, you just had to move. You know, like certain times you can listen to R&B, like, oh, that's my jam, you know, whatever. But Teddy was like, oh, you know, you got your drink, you run into, ah, oh, that's my joint.
Swing is when it go, doom, da-da-da, doom, doom, da. It's moving.
For me and for all my friends and friends, it's the first guy that made the New Jack music. I like the things you do to me. I like, that's something like that, I think.
Teddy created Rex and Effects, comprised of his brother Markel and close friends Brandon Mitchell and Akil Davidson, in an effort to get them off the streets.
And Teddy fixed it up. And we just came out with the New Jack Swing album. Rex and Effect doing New Jack Swing was like our anthem.
I got Sandman, Redhead, Boy George, James and Deja, and my homeboy's Guy, and you got to...
After 21 weeks on the R&B charts, Brandon of Rex and Effects is tragically shot during their rise to success.
I still know in my heart that, you know, he's not there. You know, and that's something that you can't bring back. Well, he was like the screw and a monkey bar. If you take that one screw out, that whole monkey bar will collapse. Just singing my song,
I'll be long. In December 89, Teddy discovered that publishing royalties had allegedly been emptied by manager Gene Griffin, who had sole authority to withdraw funds from Teddy's account. A loss of $2 million for the last 2 years was estimated.
If there was an internet out then, it would have been over, all over the velvet rope.
It could have happened to me, but I had people that was watching out for me, you know what I'm saying? So I'm just saying, like, I think his experiences that happened before him that just helped me become a better businessman as well.
Self-esteem, everything was just low. It was like gone. I would stay in bed and just eat potato chips, thought I was gonna get fat. I didn't get fat. I just had a cholesterol problem, went to the doctor. You eat too much cholesterol. One song kept me in the music industry, and that was I Don't Wanna Fall in Love. That record pulled me through. And when I did that record, I did something that I felt like I couldn't do again. So I said, if this record doesn't make it, then I quit the music industry. And it went from the streets to the rooftop to the clubs and places that I never thought that this record was gonna climb. So I started just doing stuff like that. The I Don't Want to Fall in Love. Boom, boom. And then it just running that line, and then I thought it was just gonna be a pop record. It was just God saying, you can't leave this business. And there's another song. It's time to make that change.
Well, it's time to make that change. People of the world today are fading.
In 1990, Riley filed a $10 million lawsuit against Griffin, alleging fraud, extortion, and racketeering. They settled out of court, and Teddy and Guy are released from their contract. Leaving the messy breakup behind, Guy presses on to the future, their sophomore album.
And how have fans reacted to you now, since when you first became Guy and now? They go crazy, don't they?
Well, the way it looks, they like us and we're grateful for that. You know, we're glad that they're appreciating our music and us at the same time.
You are being such a modest fellow, but I know you really sincerely mean that, though.
I do.
And you've gotten a lot of support from the fans.
Yeah.
2, 3, kick it.
People keep dissing for Jerry Curls back in the day with Teddy Riley and everybody, especially Aaron. That was some Jerry Curl all on his face. I thought it was sweat. No, it was Jerry Curl. But we love you, Teddy Riley.
So when are the rest of y'all gonna go ball?
I'm gonna do it for the third album.
And I'm not gonna ever do it unless I do it.
They think I'm joking.
Damien don't get no tattoos, he don't get no ball head, he don't.
He's curl for life.
Damien,
no.
He's S-curl. He gonna get an S-curl, he gonna be sponsored by S-curl. He gonna be sponsored by S-curl.
Jam. Oh, jam.
Teddy, jam.
Even though the album was a commercial success, the group breaks up in 1991 due to creative differences, leaving millions of their fans devastated.
Every song on there will explain our life and what we were going through, from I Want to Get With You all the way to Let's Stay Together. If you listen to it, Let's Stay Together was the end of our life and us asking each other, let's stay together. Back a lot of memories, you know, with Guy and just the whole impact on people. I'm so sorry that, you know, what happened with us breaking up and how that happened basically was, it was just a tragedy of our ex-manager.
When the door to the Guy era closed, the King of Pop unlocked another door to Teddy's biggest project to date, the Dangerous album.
I think it was great for Michael.
it was fantastic for Michael, you know, because he got a chance to go the 360 degree route, you know, musically.
And working on that album was the most incredible experience, and I felt like I needed to go back to school. So I went back to school to learn from Michael and give him what I know. All began, it just
seemed like heaven, so I did it. Michael Jackson joint, that was, of course, the fattest. I mean, that put Michael back on the map, I thought.
And when he got with Teddy, he made the whole world know that this boy is magic.
He said, Heavy D is his favorite rapper. I said, I can give Heavy D. And I said, he's like part of my family. And he said, you sure you can get him? I said, I'll call him right now. And I called him. Jam, jam, here comes the man. Hot damn, the big boy stands with an upper hand. He can pull the tracks with my man, Michael Jackson. Smooth criminal hat, the man is Mike, so relax. Mingle, jingle in the jungle. Bum rush the door, three and four, in a bundle. Execute the plan, first I cool it like a fine. Got one Janet, then we got now with Michael, cause it ain't hard. I asked him, I said, is this true that you don't pronounce your words? He said, yeah, it's my words. I pronounce my words. It's just how I say it in my accent. Like, certain words would come out, but I mimic the rest of the words. And we just started writing to all his mimic tracks. He just made me a part of that whole album.
Keep it in the closet.
When I did High Five, I liked the way Kissing Games. They were like, I didn't know you did that record. Is it good to you? They were like, you never sound the same. And people can listen today and say, he did that, and he did that too.
In late 92, Teddy started Life of Riley Entertainment with MCA Records to establish a home for his music. He developed and created acts, including a very talented group that would sell over 2 million copies nationwide.
Rump Shaker.
Rump Shaker, man.
The beat, it had a lot of, I think it was very innovative. It took music to a different level.
But once you put on Rump Shaker, it's over. That remains.
Up next, Teddy creates a group like no other. In 1993, while working on the second Bobby Brown album, Teddy and background vocalist Chauncey Hannibal started a new group, Blackstreet.
He said, you know, let's start a group. And I said, a group? What kind of group? He said, you know, he want to start a group and he want to be a part of the group. I said, you want to be a member of the group? He said, yeah.
I want to do something different. Everybody wants to go solo after doing a group. I want to do another group.
He had another guy by the name of Joseph Stone Street already down here.
Who's one of the most incredible singers on this face of the earth.
I went back to my hometown, Paterson, New Jersey, and got a guy by the name of Levi Little. The name evolved around me in the street. You know, he called me Black.
The darkest guy around the block is called Black.
We took the Joseph Stone the street off his last name and put it together and called it Black Street.
In late 93, the group's first single, Baby Be Mine, appeared on the CB4 soundtrack and achieves modest success. In 94, Joseph Stone Street left the group before the release of the self-titled album, Black Street.
Street had left because, you know, he wanted to pursue his own thing and everything, and you know, we just let him go ahead and do what he wanted to do.
Everybody's trying to pursue their career as a solo man.
I know, that's what's tripping. That's what I'm tripping on, like, because I've never heard anyone say,
You know, I never wanted to be solo. Everybody's like, oh, I always wanted to be solo.
I want to be solo because you can't look back and say, yo, fellas, help me out, you know. Yeah. And we got Dave from Jodeci, Mary J. Blige crew. Mm-hmm. He was one of the background singers, one of the main background singers with Jodeci. And also on the Mary J. Blige tour. And we said, yo, he fits the group. He's perfect. And he has the right voice. I mean,
voice is like
better
butter.
Known
it's
as
incredible.
Butter.
Released in October 94, Before I Let You Go makes its mark on the R&B charts.
Before I Let You Go was, you know, a love song about, you know, whatever you do, I'm never gonna let you go. David Hollister brought that, like, Jodeci vibe. And you know, with the strong vocals and everything. And Levi brought that high, high pitched tenor, you know what I'm saying? And basically me, I was just on the more the smooth, you know, laid back, and I can get rough a little bit, you know. And Teddy, you know, he do it all.
If a girl calls you at 2 o'clock in the morning, is that or is that not a booty call? Can you help me? It's hot, it's the bomb.
It's a booty call. Girl, you know what I like. You got it.
Yes, you are, baby.
Every little thing that I wanted, baby.
Every little thing I wanted, yeah.
Forget the day that she walked into my life.
So that song was for Michael Jackson when Teddy was working with Mike. And Mike didn't take it, so Teddy called Mike and asked him, could we use it? And it was on after that.
After all the changes, my heart had locked.
My first daughter, when she came into my life, how much joy it brought to me and, you know, my fiance. I sort of really approach it as I'm starting all over again, and I have a new group and we're a new act.
It went platinum. And I just was happy going gold because, you know, I never sold cardboard.
You know, I bet a lot of people are going to say, well, how long will this group last? I mean, is this the group?
I think this is the group.
Yeah?
Yeah.
In early 96, David Hollister and Levi Little leave to pursue solo careers and are replaced by Mark Middleton and Eric Williams.
David Hollister, it was always in his heart to be solo. Levi, he left the group for... I don't even know the reason. The three of them went, and they did a show. They did a tour in Japan, and when they came back, I never heard from Levi, and he never came back.
Confident with its new members, Blackstreet literally takes it to another level.
Teddy came up with that idea.
But people were coming in the room saying, y'all knuckles on another level.
Yeah, exactly.
And it was like, you know, when they heard No Diggity or they heard Fix, you know, some people told us we were breaking the rules.
Yeah. You know what? I like the place.
America was dancing to the Macarena, which topped the Billboard charts for 14 weeks, until they got their groove on with Blackstreet, Dr. Dre, and Teddy's female protege, Queen Penn, with their number one smash hit, No Diggity.
It's going down, face of Blackstreet, the homies got at me, collab creation.
No Diggity was No Diggity. That's all I can say, it was No Diggity. It was dope.
Described by some as a molasses groove and the Delta meets the hood, No Diggity offers smoothed out R&B with a down-home sample from Bill Withers' Grandma's Hands.
Teddy's bad. Teddy's bad. You know, I think the thing that's cool about Teddy is he's always kept music as a part of his thing, you know, even when he was sampling stuff. And he still kept it very musical.
So the video, I was nervous at first, but once I got on that stand in front of Dr. Dre and they said, action, and I heard my part come up, I was just hyped. That's why you noticed, I was like this, but we was in sand. People don't, when I look at it, then I noticed. I said, okay, you see, you playing yourself. Cause you can see me trying to really break and get down. Like, yeah, this is my chance, I'ma break.
Cause that's my peeps and we rose deep. Flying first class from New York City to Black Street. What you know about me? Now don't think of what I'm saying. Cartier wooded frame sported by my shorty. As for me, icy gleaming pinky diamond ring. We bees to buy this click up for this scene.
It touches on the past. You start thinking about what love interest you had maybe back in the day.
I'll give you all I've got to give if you say you love me too.
That song serves a big purpose to people who, you know, are sincerely, you know, friends to people, and we feel like money can't buy us love.
City is my apartment.
I think it all started when Teddy wanted to do the remix.
The remix.
We had met in Europe, and we decided to work together, to do something together.
My melody, and it's basically my life. Like, everything on an album, I've experienced it.
Little Man Records' own Royal Highness Queen Pen combines her flow with Teddy's groove to make her hit debut LP, My Melody.
Because she came in as a star, she remains with Lil Man Records because she has the vision, and that's what I'm good, and that's what I'm good with, people who have the vision that where I can help bring it through musically and visually.
In 1997, Blackstreet is awarded the highly coveted Grammy for the best R&B performance by a duo or group for No Diggity.
His last album he did, just put the one he went away and really put his head down to the grindstone. The distinguishing features about it were the studio vocalists and the greatest vocal sounds I ever heard in my life.
Up next, behind the scenes of Blackstreet's highly anticipated album, Finally. After multi-platinum success of the group's album, Another Level, Mark Middleton exits the group to go solo, leaving the door open for Terrell Phillips to enter as the new member of Blackstreet.
Through the whole journey of Another Level, we didn't know if Mark was going. Hang in there.
I don't think at any time did Teddy want to hold anybody back from what they wanted to do. It's not always been, you know, pleasant endings. It's who wants to break up a group like that? But everyone has always wanted the best for any of the guys that were doing, you know, their own thing.
I brung a little different flair to the group. It was something that, for one, they were looking for a new member. Second of all, I fit the criteria of which they were looking for from a new member.
When you enter Blackstreet, you can't do things like, you know,
smoke.
Yeah, smoke.
No drinking.
No drugs. You can't be in rehearsal and not trying your best.
You gotta give it all.
Give your all. You know what I'm saying? We got to see what you're gonna do, so we know how we're gonna do it.
I happened to get an opportunity to audition. Among some other people, and happened to be the one who got chosen. So I'm thankful for that opportunity.
With their joyful contribution to the Rugrats movie soundtrack, Take Me There, Blackstreet entertains a whole new generation of fans.
Oh,
And it took us a month to decide to do it because we didn't know how people would feel about Blackstreet. But we realized that the people who love Blackstreet have kids. Some kids stopped me on the street today, middle of nowhere, stopping at the stoplight, and they're like, that is him. So him.
No, it's not.
It's not. It is. We feel like finally we made it through the storm.
Despite membership changes, Blackstreet has managed to maintain and move on with their third album, Finally.
Chauncey is the cornerstone of Blackstreet. Eric is smooth, the Mac Daddy. Terrell is a voice to be reckoned with. Teddy is my hero. He is the man behind the music.
You got to be on your P's and Q's all the time. He doesn't just settle for what's gonna sound good. He wants to settle for what's gonna sound great.
Plenty of times where I thought, you know, he asked me to do something and I thought it was, I was right on, and I'd be happy about it, and he'd be like, no, I'll do it again.
I'm the worst in the studio. I'm gonna just admit it, you know. It's like trying to cut hard bread.
He likes to know what's going on, you know, he stays informed all the time. And he spends most of his time in the studio, and we try and take care of a lot of the business so that he can be creative.
Blackstreet, JJ, come on. Yeah, what?
We're here because we're shooting the girlfriend boyfriend video, and it's the start of the Blackstreet just empire and storm.
There weren't any creative differences. I was a little too street for him.
What Janet brings to the songs, it's like a gloss. This is like a glazed donut, and she brings the gloss to it.
Backstreet is because they gotta come through the back door. Blackstreet is because we walk right out on the street and we do our thing. That's it. What was that?
He's funny. He's silly, actually. Sometimes when the guys are asleep, Teddy will pour syrup in their mouth or hot sauce or, you know, something like that that's bound to wake them up and they won't be feeling too good when they wake up.
I do have a funny moment. We like to go fishing, so he has a boat and we go fishing from time to time. It was kind of cold and Teddy really didn't want to go. But I think he was a little nervous about getting out on the water.
You know, cause basically he used to, you know, he tried to go off on my boat talking about, you know, I got a little boat, you know what I'm saying? My joint ain't as extravagant as his, you know what I'm saying?
He got a yacht. You know, but, you know, I got a little
24 feet of, you know what I'm saying, scarab, you know, speed boat, you know what I'm saying? I ain't got a old, you know, the yacht joint, but I'll be there.
He does this thing with his stomach, and he makes his stomach bolt all the way, I swear, all the way out, and he stares like this, like an alien.
This is what I do when I get silly at night, and I'm just funny all night long, but this takes the cake. See, I have a 4-pack here, and after you see the 4-pack, like at night, 5 o'clock in the morning, 4 o'clock in the morning, I'm working with Queenpin, I get the 1-pack, and it gets crazy. And I just walk around and just do it so that I can breathe because people get on my nerves, and then put it back in. Then you see the 4-pack.
Up next, a special salute to Teddy.
Anybody to be 30 years old or anywhere around 30 years old and have already been in the business for 15 years is incredible.
Teddy's always been a pioneer, and he's always been kind of ahead of the game.
Now, I just want to say thank you to him for, you know, putting out all them records and being an inspiration to me. And as long as he kept making records, that, like, made me want to continue to make records. So I just hope I can be that same person for somebody else.
R&B before Teddy came around was, like, just like basically a stick of butter. He came with like, he was like a hot knife, and it just cut right through the butter.
You gotta have this for Teddy track.
I taught him everything he knows. I don't get the credit, but it's cool.
It's a balance between soul and science all the time. And he's that discipline, I think, you can give him a platform to go anywhere he wants to go.
He can do whatever he wants. He might just start doing reggae tracks. Who knows? I don't know.
God give you a gift. Give you a gift. Give you a gift. And you a gift. Give everybody a gift. Mike didn't give it in music, but everybody got a gift to do something. And as long as you do it and you do good at it, that's your gift.
I want to be a consultant. I want to be a person who teach the kids, because I want to see our generation grow and grow and blossom.
Riley, congratulations on your 15th anniversary. 15 years in the business. You know you got it by God.
Teddy, I just want to congratulate you on 15 years of success. I want to wish you much success in the future, and thank you for everything you've done.
He's like a ghetto Mozart.
Hi, this is Face, just wanting to wish Teddy a happy 15th anniversary. You're the man, always will be.
I got your back 1,000%. Anytime you need me, and you just keep on doing what you're doing, and I'll be there for you.
He made the whole world dance.
Oh, Teddy Riley,
super producer.
Oh man, super producer, man. You the bomb, brother.
That's right.
You're the man. Hey, congratulations. 15 years. Man, your brother getting old, ain't he?
Pretty old, brother.
I want to know how old he is, man. What, are he the new Jack Swing? What's he now?
Now he old Jack
old
Swing.
Old Jack
now.
Swing.